Okay, well, I want then to start with two new images then of, you might say, border posts. So I started off last time with looking at the way in which with looking at the way in which law as an imperial code is a way monologic organization imposes or presupposes a certain sort of life. So the people who believe that living by the book in that way have a theory of law as an imperial code in that way, they will live and organise their lives in a particular way. And a society that believes in that will also, in that way, live that life. And that sort of life, living by the book, with the law as an imperial code, is what Judith Sklar called legalism. That is to say, you follow the rules, follow the law, as though that is all there is, and that the law in itself can be also viewed, in the image I gave of it, as a boundary rather like the boundary of the... That boundary between Mexico and the USA, a wall which encloses and insulates everything from the outside. So living in that way is a way in which we conquer our fear. Our fear of the disruption of what might go on outside, of what might upset our world, change it, and which might make sorts of changes that could actually be necessary for our well-being. And I gave examples of the ways in which people personally live their life in Antigone and Creon, and in the ways in which a society lives. The most notorious example of that sort of society being, of course, the Third Reich, the egoistic society. But many other societies, of course, still see themselves as bound by that, refusing to look beyond the rules, thinking of the law as that opaque boundary which makes everything outside of it invisible. Okay, what I wanted to do was look at the ways in which, you might say, the boundary can be slightly more porous, can make us see and look to the outside, and help us, you might say, to change. What images do we have here? Well, this is an image of a border, which is the border between Germany and Poland. And what's interesting about that is that you can see that in it there is a middle which is a kind of transitory zone. So you go in, you leave Poland, then you go and then you enter Germany. In the middle of that, you might say it's a transition period where the legal status in real terms is not clear. And also it's an image of what I use, of the space where transitions can be negotiated. So this, in a way, is one image of a way in which the border can stand outside. And if you think of that, in a way, it's still, in some sense, it's a border where, though there are transitions, we move from the one to the other, the border posts, but as we move from the one to the other, we move back into the zone where everything's clear again. So we move, we might change sorts of things within that border, and then we change. Think of the way an analogy of that, of understanding it, is through systems theory. And the systems theory way of understanding the trial. So the trial is, on one view, a way of solving a dispute between two people. And it solves that dispute between two people. But at the same time, in solving that dispute, it creates what Luhmann and others call normative surplus. It creates all sorts of rules, all sorts of things, which then the trial system, the legal system, can use in further cases. But in the end, that, the solving of the problem of the people, is irrelevant, ultimately, for the next case and the next case and the next case. The legal system takes something from there, uses it. So it takes feedback from the outside, from two people who are annoyed about a problem, and it's being solved. And then uses it in law. But then it gets dislocated from that people. So in a way, it's as though I come out of Poland, through the transitional zone, certain things happen to me, I change, certain things that I thought of, I change, I go into Germany, and then I lose all those things. I don't know that they came from there. They become then part of the new system. So this mode of transition, one might say, keeps a border opaque, but leaves a space in which you can change it. And there is another mode of doing that, which is this image, which is the image I mentioned before, the image of a Catholic chapel in Edinburgh, the Dominican University chaplaincy. And what's important about that is if you look at the picture of it, what the picture shows you is the sanctuary where the altar is. But what's important about it is if you look back, and if you're in the chapel, you don't realise that there's a glass wall. It's actually a glass wall right at the end around it. If you're in it, it's very difficult to see that glass. You think somehow that it's open to the outside. And what's important about that, forgetting about it, if you think of it in terms of a theological imagery, but then you can think about it in terms of the imagery you're using now, what's important about that is that what it's doing is seeing that the most sacred space, one particular space in that area, in the church, is at the same time outside. You can't make the distinction between, it's not closed off. It's as though the sacred space is both inside and outside. It's as though you're living in a particular border. You're living in the borderlands. Once you're there, you're living both in the holy space and in the sacred and in the profane space, because you can't see you outside one way or the other. And that's an image of a border, if you think of law, where actually we're there, the border is something that we're negotiating all the time, that we're living already in both sides of both areas. So we live in a sort of negotiation, I suppose. And for a physical representation of this, just trying to find your finger, is this borderlands or transitional space is shown by a Polish artist and also activist, Krzysztof Krzyzewski, founding director of a thing called the Borderlands Foundation, an organization based in Sejny on the frontier of Poland-Ukraine. And it encourages, or the point of it there is to encourage and facilitate cross-border dialogues. Because what he thinks is important in these areas is where you get unification, change, because there you're continually negotiating different sorts of identities and other things that you have. And it's there that you have a chance to reinvent, you might say, a different sort of public space, a different sort of community. And then this borderland, for him, gives rise, you might say, to what he thinks of as democracy. So in the images of Weinstein, it's here that law meets politics. Politics and law can't be separated, one system from the other, which one sometimes intrudes and changes and vice versa. They're mixed. They're inextricably mixed. And in being mixed, they influence and change each other. So the border in these situations, instead of being a zone of exclusion, becomes a zone of transformation. It's the area where we change, where we make things different. And what here, then, is that what I'm saying is you can see this as both a physical space, physical space of border countries which tend to do that, borderlands. And of course Poland has many such spaces because it's on many borders. And also a normative space where you're living in the middle of law, politics, of the outside influences that come to us. That what I've often called love, but was often seen as the contingent, arbitrary passion that fuels law, as it were. And in that, and for what lawyers have to do, and what And what we need in our lives is to understand how, in these situations, we govern our lives. Okay, let's start then with another small story. And this lady before is the kind of parable of the anxious judge. Imagine a world where, or a judge, where there's still on access readily to the internet and to computers and to all these sorts of things. A judge going on circuit, going away from his hometown and making decisions, and he comes across a particularly hard case where he's not sure of the law. He's not quite sure what the law is. And he doesn't know whether he's right or wrong about the doctrine. But he makes a decision. And he comes back, finally, to his home, rushes in to check his books, and he finds that the law, he got the law right. And does he then go, it's all right, I've got it right? No, because in some respects he might still be, because there is another way in which he might still be anxious. Because the fact that he got the doctrine right doesn't necessarily mean to him that the decision was right anyway. It still might be a hard case. And the law says you should do this, but it might not be quite right, the right thing to do. In the examples of Crayon and Antigone, the law tells you that, but in the end, something else breaks through. It might not be the right thing to do, they're not sure what to do. And that's because, in more abstract technical terms, you might say there's a distinction between what the doctrine is and whether or not the doctrine should be applied. Because it might be the case that it is unreasonable or wrong to apply a reasonable rule. And the obvious example of that, a very straightforward example that I gave in the seminar, I'm on a bus heading into the sea and I don't jump off because I apply the rule which says you can't leave a vehicle when it's moving. And when I'm at, or perhaps the other way around, if I'm on the bus and I jump off to save myself from going into the sea, and I'm then charged by the police and fined by the courts because I broke the rule, I broke the rule that you can't go off the bus while it's in motion. We all think that's crazy, but actually, some people would think, well, it's the law. Should pay it. And the point then is, the way you understand that is the rule is perfectly reasonable. It makes sense. It's a valid law. But it's unreasonable in this particular case to apply it. And what that means is there's a difference between the discourse of justifying it and finding out what the norm is and the discourse of applying it in any particular case. Because in particular cases, you always have to look at what the factors and everything is are at the moment. And the judge in that situation always finds him or herself in that position. And it's the position that Detmold calls the particularity for. But he's got to make a decision about a rule which applies in that particular case. And it's a way of saying you're living in the middle. In the middle, that is to say, you're living in between systems, you're living in transitional areas, you're living in a place where you're not firmly in one system or the other, you're in a border, and you've got to make a decision. And you've got to make a decision and then live with it. And what we always find is that we're scared of making that decision. Because we're frightened it might go wrong, so we stick to the rules, because we always think at least the rules will tell us we're right. And of course, that's precisely the story that Kant gives. Kant, who had a theory of saying that the rules are categorical, the categorical imperative is you must do what you can universalize to act to everybody, and there is no change in that. When asked, well, okay, can you tell a lie to save a life? You deny that. And the answer they would give is that once, if you break the rule, you act illegally or act against the right, then you would be liable for whatever happened because you didn't act correctly. So take an example. Somebody comes to me here with a gun and says, can you tell me where Stambulski is? Because I want to kill him. Really hate him. And I kind of want to save his life because he's given me a burst of deals. And so I say he's actually in the marketplace, knowing that he's actually at home. So the guy rushes there, and Stambulski's there meeting some woman illicitly, and the guy shoots him. And what Kant will say is, I'm responsible for that because I lied. I broke the categorical imperative. I acted not morally, not ethically, and therefore I'm responsible because I tried to save his life, and I'm responsible for that because I did something wrong to save a life. If I said I can't tell a lie and he's there and the public goes and kills him, I'm not responsible because I didn't do anything wrong. I merely told the truth. The other person killed him. And it's, and in a way, what rules are precisely that. It's a theory that says we can't know what's right or what's best to do at any time, because that's too hard, and nobody agrees. But we can all agree that if we follow the rules and everything, then we haven't done wrong. So what we must do is always never to do something wrong. And that's the kind of way of trying to dampen down our anxiety, trying to escape from the fact that when we live in this particular place, we always have, in the end, to make a choice. We make a choice to follow or not follow the rules. And an example of this is, you might say, from Tolstoy, from War and Peace. In War and Peace, Davout is about to shoot to execute Pierre. And Tolstoy says, he holds his rifle, looks at him, hesitates, and doesn't fire. Tolstoy says that at that moment of hesitation, many things passed through his mind. He looked at the war, saw the war men were brothers, he saw all those sorts of things, and he chose not to fire. And though that moment can be seen as mystical, it's what one legal theory said, that's when poetry, mysticism and everything enters the law. It's an experience, the everyday experience of law. Every time, and our own decision, every time we make a decision, we have to decide whether or not we apply the law or not. So in some ways, we renew the law. We make the law, of course, to act normally, to act straightforwardly, but we always, in the end, have to choose. And it's that space, that mystical space, that kind of space, where you might say law meets love or politics or the chaos that law is trying to prevent. Law hates chaos. The whole point of law is to make things predictable, as I said in the Weberian story. Chaos always breaks through. It's always there, trying to break through into our lives. A voice that tells us sometimes we have to do something else. And that is what Julian Rose, a philosopher, calls living in the middle. And it's an anxious place, because in those decision-making moments, we have to be anxious, because we have to be anxious about precisely what it is we do. We can't be sure in the end. The answers we will give will work out, but we have to take that leap. So when I meet the man who wants to shoot Stambolsky, I have to at least decide to try and save his life. I fail, but I can't just say, oh well, I'll just tell the truth, because then at least I can't be blamed. And that's the point. And let me then give an example of what that sort of being means. It means, in the end, that judgment, that decision making, means paying very, very careful attention to the case, to the way the case is organised, to what happens. You've got to pay attention. You can't just say, ah, I know the answer, here are the rules. If you think of our legal experience, quite often, we always try and force the answer into the case or anything else, into the optic of the law, of the code, because it's easier. And often it's the right thing to do. Nevertheless, we have to decide and be careful and know whether in this case we should do it or not. And we have to pay attention. And in paying attention, we see what we might have to do. And here is an example of this. In a book called A Common Humanity, Love and Law and Justice, Ray Guyter, a philosopher from Australia, writes about an experience that happened to him when he was a young man. As a young man, he worked in a mental hospital. And in that mental hospital, as was the case in the 1960s, the warders or the nurses treated the inmates like dirt, like animals. cruel and vicious. And some other people, like some of the doctors, and even Gandhi says he himself, try to be caring and better. They try to treat them as humans in a way. And yet, there was somebody there who put them all to shame in the way she dealt with them. And this was a nun who, he said, in the way she dealt with the inmates there, made them all feel that they weren't any different from the warders. She had something about her, something about her interaction with those people that was completely different. And what Gaita tries to do in his book is to try and understand what that experience means for moral philosophy. What you say, he says, is that the nun had something about her that she did that made these people human in a way in which they, people who were wanting to be kind, couldn't, because she treated them as equals, not just in some intellectual way, but in some real way. An example I might give of that would be when I was a student, a friend of mine used to go to an orphanage and help out. And there were many people there too. And he used to play football with the kids. And you know, when you normally play football with children like that, you kind of let them win. Or you play, you don't really take part. But he actually took part, he really wanted to win. And he used to kick them, play hard, and things like that. And the thing was, we all thought that's silly, you know, why didn't he do it? But actually, of course, he was engaging with them. He didn't see them as somehow inferior beings. So his attitude to them was somewhat different from even the people who wanted to help. And it's something about something like that that I think that the nun was doing. And what's important about that is that what Gaita says, and Gaita bases a lot of his stuff on the readings of Simone Weil, is that in a way what she did in looking at and treating them like that is make the invisible, make these people visible, make them see, make them actually appear. So in Honneth's term, she recognized them. And that act brought them in a way to life. The point about that is that for her, the experience of her compassion or her love didn't come from following, because she was a nun and a Christian, from following the rule of, you know, we must all treat the poor as good or kind and things like that. It came from something deep in her heart. It wasn't about the rules of the church or of theology. It was something about her that recognised these people and made them visible. And there is, if you think this is fanciful, there is sociological work that says that in prisons, warders treat their inmates, the convicts, better if they have many visits from other people. Why? Because they then see them as some people who can be loved. They're made visible. The fact that they might be horrible and others, somebody comes and sees them, visits them makes the other people feel that they're more somehow worthy. They're visible, they suddenly become visible to people's eyes. And it's that gaze, that paying attention to them, seeing of that vulnerability that makes that difference. And in a way, and that's why, for example, Simon Weil thought of the parable of the Good Samaritan. Because the parable of the Good Samaritan, for her, shows all sorts of things. If you know the story, then at one level it clearly shows that Christ says you must see people who are enemies as friends. But the point of it is this, that you can see the parable as a description. So when the judge, so in the story, Christ is asked, what are the commandments? And he gives the answer, what should you do? He gives the answer in absolute conformity with the law, Judaism, love for God and thy neighbour as thyself. And the lawyer asks him to test him, and who is my neighbour? And he gives the story. There are a couple of interesting things about it. First of all, when Christ says love that, when you think of the parable as being about love thy neighbour, who is the neighbour in that? You see, it's not the vulnerable person on the fallen down, it's the Samaritan who's the one with the rich. Because Christ says, who was the neighbour to that to the injured party? Do thou likewise, so be like that. That can come too late, but in a way you can understand the parable as saying that when Christ says love thy neighbour, he's giving a rather wider definition of what counts as neighbour. So what he's saying is that neighbours must include people who are with the law, like the Samaritan and others. So it's kind of like a very legalistic definition. It's saying, yeah, you've got to follow the law, but you've got the law wrong. You know, it's wider than you think. Or you can see it, as Peter Winch and other philosophers have said, as performative. That is, what Christ is saying is that make someone your neighbour by acting in a neighbourly way to them. When you see them as vulnerable, act like a neighbour to them and they will become your neighbour. So the point there is, if you act in that way, you connect with them. You connect with them, and you make them your neighbour. You make them from being invisible to being visible. And that's what, in a way, the nun is doing. The nun is connecting with someone like that. And the point is, and the question is, that this for him is a way in which moral philosophy comes through. And he then says, well, if you think we should live our lives and build societies based on compassion, based on love that we feel for someone, then that's mad, because not enough people do that, it's not going to happen all the time, how can we base a society on these contingent feelings and so on? And what he says is that's true. And Kant's right that you need some organisation, you need some rules. But why would we ever want to help anybody? Why would we ever want to have a society which has rules of welfare, rules and things like that to make things better? Unless we felt that, unless someone felt that act of compassion to someone. Because otherwise we just wouldn't bother. We wouldn't care. There'd be no reason for us to do that. So what he's saying is because if you think of, say, something like the welfare state, or a state and our law, as to do with the way in which we organise socially the welfare of our fellow humans. So it's about compassion made socially. That never gets started unless we have the experience of doing it ourselves. Because we never see them until somebody looks at them and points them out to us. You think of this politically. Nobody, not even the most right-wing people, say, well, we should kill the poor. Maybe Trump. Should kill the poor, there are too many of them, they're stupid, they're not worth saving. But I like to just starve them. You know, it's better that we have the money and so on and so on. They don't say that. They basically say there aren't any poor. There are no poor, there are nobody who's not rich, it's a lie, it's a mistake, everyone can get enough money and so on and so on. Because they don't see that, they choose not to see that. All the poor and those and the destitution and the are invisible. In our society now, say in Britain there's a general election going on between some quite right-wing Tories, Conservatives and Labour. Many of the people in the Labour Party are saying, you know, these Tories are evil, they kind of hate the poor and things like that. But actually, what they do is they don't see them. They choose not to see them. It's only when they see, when people see things, that people are spurred to do things. You think of that. Think of the... some years ago, there were two deaths at the same time. There was the death of Princess Diana, who was somebody the wife of future King of Britain at the time, or the estranged one, and Mother Teresa. And they both died, and there was a letter saying how good they were, they did all sorts of things. I mean, they both showed acts of compassion, as it were. Diana famously hugged people with HIV and was compassionate with hers, and Mother Teresa. And there was a letter in the liberal newspaper, the kind of soi-disant caring newspaper of Britain, the Guardian, which said, Mother Teresa and Lady Diana were both really nice people, but they didn't really were very effective because they didn't have a political solution to any of these things. They just hugged the odd person. So they did nothing. It's worth them to need a political solution. What they don't realise is that the only way you have a political solution is if you actually recognise that there is a problem. And the point, and this is specifically the case with Princess Diana, for example, this is what happened, that there was no government and other funding for HIV for people ill in those particular ways in Britain, and they weren't seen or ignored. It was only when she actually on television hugged a patient who was dying of AIDS that suddenly people saw that there were patients and people dying. And then there was funds. But it's in a way, the experience of the individual act of compassion sparks the social act of compassion. And Guyton says that in these situations, he has, we need, because not everyone can be compassionate in that way, we need what he calls secular saints, like the nun and others. It's not about religion, but about people who model and show what it is to have that compassion. And in doing that, they spark off the need for social change and for social systems to help and organise those. So in that way there, what is important in all these cases is that what is happening is that someone is paying attention, someone is looking at something in a careful way and letting themselves be moved by that. And in that movement, creating the force and the possibility of change. But that's always difficult and dangerous. But in a way, in a smaller way, all our lives are a mixture of making decisions according to well-founded rules and suddenly changing them. At each moment we make a decision, we have to choose whether or not we follow the established rules or we don't. And what makes us make that decision in the end is how we view the particular case. And what is important then, say for the judge and for us, is the ability to pay attention to that case, to the particularity of the case, and then, in the end, decide whether or not you should follow the rules or change them. But that can only be done if we're trained as judges and decision makers to be careful about what happens, to look at a case carefully, to be careful about making that decision. And in that way, then, that's part of the way in which the form of life of law that I'm talking about means inhabiting a space which is continually in motion. Though you have the rules, you are continually interrogating them with each make decision you make. It doesn't mean that you don't follow the rules. It means that in all those particular instances, you choose. And of course, in our normal lives, in the ways in which we live, we have a mixture of both, and we need them. Though we make the choices, each time we're responsible for each choice we make, we can't live as though everything we choose to do is an existential choice. So if I lived like an existentialist, I couldn't move from here to the room to outside because I have to think, should I stand up? I'm not sure. Look around, people might not like it. They might not think I'm important enough, something like that. Then I start to do that. And as well, should I go out to the door? And gradually, I actually just end up here and do nothing. But that's the kind of metaphor of someone who is continually having to make decisions. They can't, in the end, do any. But the alternative, as I was saying, is, of course, you just follow the rules all the time. But our life has to be a situation where we tend to follow rules, by and large, so we have a rule, but we know and we can say when it's appropriate to change and move them. Because we're living in a border and all the time. So we create institutions and systems which enable us to change, which enable us to see when we have to change something. Think of a couple of examples of that. I don't know if you have many written examples. Do they have many written examples of the book? Okay, when I started being an academic teacher, it took me about 3 weeks to mark 20 exam scripts because I was so careful, I wasn't sure it was all right and so on and so on. Now, as you grow older, you can mark about 200 in 5 minutes. And part of the reason is everyone writes exactly the same answer, and it makes no difference what the question is. We'll still answer the same. And you read, you get the ability to read very, very quickly, or skim through it, and recognise the ones that are different, the ones that are odd. And you stop with the ones that are odd, and be careful, and read them carefully. And some of them are really good, and some of them are really bad. But the trick then is you have a system, as it were, where the average is normal, so you give the same mark to virtually everybody because they're all doing exactly the same thing. And you spot the anomalies. And that's in a system where, for example, you don't have specialists, where the first port of call when you're ill is to a general practitioner who sees you for 10 minutes. What these people do is train very quickly to see if everything is normal or it's the normal case. They normally say, okay, 3 aspirins or something like that. But they spot something strange and they move you up to the specialist. In the same way we do that. But the trouble with that is that you can become blasé or you can become confident, complacent. So you think you know everything. You've seen it all, so you don't pay enough attention, and you don't spot the different, you don't spot the one that stands out. So we need, in our, you might say, our legal systems, to organise them in such a way where we can do that, where we can have institutionally a system where the law is applied, and suddenly it is disrupted, it stops, and somebody has to think more carefully about it. And one of the ways in which that system works, say, in common law countries, is the system of juries. Because what juries do is apply a non-legal logic to law, and sometimes they make decisions which are against what the lawyers will think of as the law. And in doing that, they disrupt the system and make the legal system think again. And there are different sorts of institutional ways of putting that into place in the law, but they're all there in order to make sure that the law doesn't, in the end, just become the machine that rolls on, and just decides what the rules are according to the rules. It's rather like, if you remember, I gave the example of the cashline machine in the first lecture, the ATM machine, where that acts like the law. I put the card in, it reads it, and if I haven't got any money in my bank account, it doesn't give me any money. And there's no pleading about it. I can't say, please give me some money, I need it this time. But what we need is a machine that can do that by and large, but recognise when it is that it's correct. So the machine must have built in, you might say, a sympathetic bank manager who suddenly comes out and they realise that that's when you need the money. But the point in that money, and the point in all of those things is, it's still, in the end, a difficult and problematic thing to do, because we can't always be sure, still, what the answer is. So we're always, in the end, in making these decisions, including in the law, always making these decisions provisionally. We know the law kind of helps us, but we're not sure if it's true or right. We know sometimes we have to change it. We're always making those kinds of decisions, but we have to take a risk, and we have to take a move sometimes to take and accept something that's different from the outside, so that we can change ourselves. And in a way, this is what we can then think of instituting the rule of law as a democratic way. And I'll give you two examples of that. Of institutions that can be seen as borderline, as institutions where we're placed in those positions and we have to make those kinds of decisions. So Europe, in a way, think of Europe as this, that it's something. What Europe is a strange way of describing it, but one might think of Europe as something born out of our love. Why? And that's literally the case. It starts with Monet, Schumann, and the others in 1946, founding the German steel community or something like that, the iron and steel community, because they want no more war after the Second World War. So they want peace. So in a sense, so how to get friendship between nations, they make out of their joining together the European steel community that becomes the EU. And the unity of that, the European Union is expressed in some respects in Brussels in the ways in which the institutions of Europe, the European institutions, work and relate to all the other countries. But that's the product of the love, you might say, between Germany and France, which starts the European Union, which then creates the European Union. If you think of that, like a model of the Trinity. The love of the Father and the Son created through the Spirit. But the point is that in that, and as more countries join, the more you have that. So the unity of Europe is the relationship between France, Germany, all the other countries in Europe, and also the relationship of the European institutions with all of those. Though they're seen as overarching in a way, they're not, because they're also part of the kind of horizontal way in which we manage the system. So it's as though the institutions of Europe both are things that are the overarching unity of Europe, but also play a part in the creation of the identity of Europe. Because the identity of Europe as Europe is the relations of all of these models. And it's rather like, I mean, it is in some respects, if you think of the Christian doctrines of the Trinity. So God is the relationship between the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost in a tripartite relation. And the unity of that is merely what we think of as God. But there is no overarching God the Father in that sense. There's no overarching person over God. It's the unity of those. Whereas you might say, in Europe, it's the unity is there is no overarching thing in it, even though it appears that Europe is. You think of it another way. Think of grammar. Think of grammar. When you think of, say, language, you have different ways of looking at language. Grammar is the way in which we understand our language. Grammar is what makes our language real. So it's the overarching, it's technically a different language. It's the language that tells us how to speak our own language. So it constrains and controls our language. But you think of the different ways in which grammar works. Think of a country like France, where the Académie Française make rules about what counts as grammar and what correct French is. So, for example, a hamburger is called steak haché, because that's French. Actually, it's wrong. It should be hamburgeois, because hamburger is not doesn't describe a chopped up steak. It describes something that people in Hamburg eat. In English, grammar is actually quite close to the language it constrains. So in English, when we speak, the grammar is kind of pretty loose, and it's quite often changed by the usage. So the usage, our normal language and the grammatical language, interact and interplay with each other. So neither is kind of overarching. And if we think of constitutions or constitutional courts in the English way, then they both kind of overarch and at the same time are influenced by the other state and the other country. So you think of it. I, for example, when somebody phones me and says, "Is this Professor Bankowski?" I absolutely grammatically correctly say, "Yes, this is he." I don't say, "It's me," because that's wrong, because you're using me as an accusative. Me as an accusative, and it has to be a nominative because it's a verb to be. But now, that's probably wrong. Because the language has changed in such a way that it's incorrect really to say that this is he. You should just say it's me. But in France, if you said that, you'd be shot. And in a way, then, I think that we can see the rule of law on that model, on that sort of model, as something slightly different from the ways in which we think of it as a constraining device. We might think of the rule of law as, put it this way, as the place or the space where we can engage with others and transform ourselves. That is to say, that when we look at the rule of law, it's not the guide. It's not just that our guide to what to do, it's also one of the things that we use when we live in this borderland space and begin the way in which we negotiate our various identities. All of these things are extremely risky and problematic. And the rule of law in that space is both something which constrains us, but it's also something that's part of the way in which we change our identity. And that is, in a way, a dangerous and a hard and a fragile thing to do. Because always there are possibilities of danger and move. And in a way, in this particular thing arose in Britain when the Archbishop of Canterbury, Rowan Williams, gave a talk to lawyers about Sharia law. Sharia law was the equivalent of the Islamic version of, say, Talmud, of Mosaic law. He said it's inevitable at some times that Sharia law will be recognised by the courts, the state courts. And of course, what he was saying is something that obviously private international lawyers will know. That is to say that the courts will recognise decisions given by Sharia courts in certain situations because they've already, because they represent what the parties want and have decided. As the courts recognise the Mosaic law in certain marriage situations, not all. And it's the way in which, for example, a foreign legal system will recognise elements of a legal system will recognise elements of the private law of a foreign system. For example, in divorce, if I get married in Germany and choose to get divorced in Britain, the question is going to be, under what circumstances, how will the property be divided? And the answer in British law is under the German system, but that decision is made by the British system. So there you've got these collisions of different laws, of different spaces making different decisions. That's with laws, but also they can be done, and this is my point, with systems of politics, with systems of love, and the others, and they all in this transitional zone play a part. And even though, in some sense, the law overarches it, it also is both vertical and horizontal. It plays a part in both sides and elements of it. So what the law is doing is both being the space, being part of the space, but also part of the game of making that decision in the space. And it's important in that way. And in that sense, everything is interactive and dangerous and delicate. But if we go back, you might say, to the point that we started with the Polish constitutional crisis, It's that sort of point that's difficult to recognise here, difficult to recognise in different ways, is that neither side really thinks of it as there being a space in which to make those delicate, fragile moves, because people aren't ready for it. People are scared, people don't want to do that. There are all sorts of institutional reasons for that. There are reasons of theory, because people want to live a particular sort of legal life, or a particular sort of political life. And there are also reasons, which, as I said before, are psychoanalytic reasons. That is to say, because they're scared of losing bits of their identity. And this is my point. When you think of the law as interactive, as changing, then part of the problem is that as we grow, as I said before, by exchange, by changing, we can be said in some ways to die. Because each time I give something to someone else, myself is changed and reconstituted, you might say I'm no longer the self I was. And if you think of it in those terms, think of it, if I were a... When I was a young Catholic pious boy, if I knew what I'd become now, I wouldn't have gone to university. I just stopped because I didn't want to be that sort of evil person. But the point is, I was afraid of myself dying. Identity changes with the ways in which we change at each time. And the law is part of that and the way it guides us into doing that. But we're scared of that. We're scared of that change. That's why we're scared of law, models of law, which mean they interact with different things, because they change the way we are, they change our identity in different ways. So you think of that. So when Christ said, I have conquered death, in a secular way, what he might have meant is that in the process of my changing identity, of growing myself, there will be no boundaries. I will look through boundaries, I will include others, and they might change me. Yeah.
Stop. 5 minutes.
Yeah, sorry?
5 minutes.
Okay, fine. I will include others, and they will change me. And as they change me, I'll be a different sort of person. And you can see that jump that the first apostles make when Peter suddenly starts eating non-kosher food. You don't have to be a Jew to be Christian. And in the same way, what we worry, as I said before, about migration, is that we continually fear about dying. And that's the kind of irony of both of Benedict and John Paul, who both attacked Europe expanding to Islam and migration in that way because it was Judeo-Christian. At one level, it's deeply anti-Christian because they were saying, we must hide behind these borders. We don't want these other people to change us in any sort of way. We're scared of that change. And what law does, all the time, what one vision of law does, one border keeps that change all the time, so it keeps Europe as a barrier. Other one is more porous, it changes and we change. But we have to be careful, because every time we change, it's a risk and it's a choice, and we're stuck. But I have to make that choice each time. So let's then finish with the poem, which I didn't realise of you didn't speak English, so I left it in Polish. And that's a poem called Jezdziesz by Jerzy Lieber. And it's about choice, so let me read it to you. our reasoning was there and what we should do. I translated by me. Fear led me running from you, led me cheating you to deceive. Yet each day my knees bent so stubborn, on the sky their pale traces leave. Overtaken by you, heavenly rider, defeated by your grace laid low, you trample, stand over me bent double, like the smoke where the wind does blow. I can't say how to lift myself from you, words weigh me down, becoming absurd. Perhaps all my words should stay silent, to allow the words of the soul to be heard. I must leave myself, my poor language behind, putting my trust in your words alone. Jump into the depths of your being, follow you all the way down, your soldier. And this is the important bit for my lecture, this last stanza. I need no more help to know this. Nothing new to see or hear. The choice once made for eternity, that each encounter I must confront anew. And that's what we have to do as lawyers. Each time we make that choice, which says this is the way the world is fixed, the next time we're not sure, we have to change and we have to do that. And that's what I commend to the Polish constitutional crisis and to you. Thanks very much.